it's a pleasure to be here. And as a scientist, what I'm not going to do is geek out on you and give you a tutorial on the latest, greatest science that we're doing, although I'll touch on that in part. I do want to make 4 points on this topic of new breakthroughs in research and policy that make California special. One is that the policymakers, the legislators and the regulators, are readily accessible and listen to science at all stages. When in 2005, the day after Christmas, I got a call from an unknown person saying, we need your help because we want to do for clean energy what had just been done for stem cells, make California the leading place in the world, picking up what the federal government had dropped off. And let's get a ballot initiative together. In order to do that, I found myself in the middle of a very interesting set of alliances with Mary Nichols, with Ralph Cavanagh, with people from utilities like John Bryson, had to write the definition legally on a physics basis of what renewable energy was that would be an amendment to the Constitution of the state of California. This turned out to be the most tightly contested ballot initiative in the history of our nation. It lost. The programming that would have been involved was ahead of its time and should have won. It was to subsidize and get zero tailpipe emission vehicles on the road in massive numbers. It was to support R&D at our state's national laboratories, small businesses, and private and public universities to work and train a workforce in clean energy technology and to build an energy innovation ecosystem cluster like a Silicon Valley based on an energy technology innovation system to make us rich with energy while also supporting our climate and development goals. We moved the needle, though, and when Fran Pavli in 2012, my personal legislative hero, as many of us share, wanted to get the legendary tailpipe emissions that was now alluded to legislation through. She called up people like Dan Sperling at UC Davis and myself and listened to the scientists to help craft legislation that could be implemented, as opposed to things that are dreaming that would add a lot of cost and would add a lot of delay. And so we had an important role to play. When the federal government, I was part of the America's Energy Future Study, had a study on the panel that I was on, electricity from renewables, that I was left unsatisfied with because of, in the end, plain vanilla statements were made that everybody could sign off on. When Jane Long of Livermore, now at the Breakthrough Institute, and I rehashed that, we decided that since California had just signed an executive order, not in the past too long, by the governor, Schwarzenegger, to get emissions target of 80% reduction, that how would we actually implement that technically? What was blue sky? What was just learning by doing? And where did we need technology breakthroughs, like in storage, like in low carbon emission transportation fuels on a net greenhouse gas cycle? And so the California Commission on Science and Technology, and Susan Hawkwood's right over there, commissioned a study that I was delighted to be a leading force in, along with Jane, that is still, you can find it on the web, it's, I view, a landmark study because it still is a roadmap that has been used by CARB. We briefed Mary Nichols and her team, we briefed the CEC and their team as to how California could contribute, what were the unique and generic technologies that we could rely on, what couldn't we rely on that we had to develop, and where we could just learn by doing and ride learning curves out. And this is critical in order to understand the role of science and technology in economic growth and in getting to these energy solutions. California seamlessly listened to the scientists, and so that's very rewarding for us. That's point one. Point two is that it's also a proving ground to incorporate scientific data and studies into policy. A study that I just co-led with Ken Caldera of Carnegie Institution at Stanford just appeared last Tuesday, where we for the first time actually asked the question of what are the natural resource variabilities in solar and wind as a function of the entire region over which you aggregate it. Is it true that the wind really blows somewhere all the time? The California utilities will anecdotally tell you not true, because there are data for a limited 1 month period showing the decorrelation or lack thereof between Tehachapi and Altamont Pass and San Gorgonio, or three major wind sites in the state. But if you got an increased grid, would you actually smooth that out, and to how much would you benefit and to what extent? Well, this study, just released Tuesday, published in the leading journal, Energy and Environmental Science, in the world on this topic, that I happen to be editor-in-chief of, has gotten a lot of press. I highly recommend it. It's rigorous. We have hourly data for 36 years of the entire wind velocity and solar vector field over the globe. And this is the only way you can answer a question about how much storage do we need in order to get reliability that modern economies demand. Because if you're building a grid for 40 years in your assets, you can't afford to use 3 years worth of weather data and then figure out you've got 3 weeks worth of a blackout coming in year five. You've got to analyze 40 years of data, and you've got to do it with hourly resolution with 10 kilometer spatial scale, which we did do for the first time. And I am sure that we are going to be briefing the CEC and CARB very soon about, as well as the utilities, about the impacts that it has on how much actual storage capacity you need to avoid blackouts and meet the 99.97% FERC mandated reliability. Well, it turns out it's not so simple, because there are weeks, in fact, where there are unpredictable weather events across integrated the entire United States over a 36-year period, when every night the sun doesn't shine and the wind simply does not blow. And what happens with storage is you need to buy more and more storage used less and less frequently, and that means the numerator goes up and the denominator goes down, which means the cost goes up like the square. And so to avoid blackouts on seasonal storage or on month storage, getting to 80% is one thing, getting to 99.97% is an entirely other thing, and we have the cost curves and the duty cycles for the first time that California, that New Hampshire, that regions of the United States, that we are now porting to Africa, to China, because we can do this analysis globally. And we know that the first uptake of this in policy is going to be in California, because that's where the wheels are greased to do it. The third point is that we have fostered innovation in breakthrough areas where we simply don't have the technology that we need, as spurred in part by the CCST study. Those two areas are massive grid-scale storage, and there ain't no such thing as a plug-in hybrid airplane. So how do you do this in a carbon-neutral way? If you're going to really stabilize concentrations, you can't have any emissions, and that means everything has to be decarbonized. My passion in our research is to do that by the silver bullet, which is to take the biggest resource known to mankind, the sun, and to store it in the most dense form known to man other than the nucleus of an atom, in chemical bonds. Plants figured this out, but they don't do it very well. And so our job is like a bird flies, but airplanes aren't built out of feathers, is to do it better than a plant ever did, and to do photosynthesis with the sun to make stored chemical fuels that can be used to power our grids, that could be used to store our energy, that could be used to have our transportation fuels made seamlessly. And that's what we work on in my research group, in my passion, with my graduate students and postdocs at Caltech. And the state stepped up in order. I could tap on that through the California Engineer Commission with the backing of Fran Pavley when it came time to get the federal government to make that award for the one unique energy innovation hub in the United States. We won that award, and we had the backing of the state in terms of matching funds to help enable us to show that California meant business and that it was going to step up to the challenge to do this in its state in a way that the nation deserves to have happen. That was the third point. The fourth point is that it does, but I want to set this up a little bit for the next speaker, could do more to continue to really foster the innovation that is going to be needed in order to give us the clean energy solutions that we all want and deserve at a cost that everybody can afford. We need to make these next generation of batteries that are not anything like the batteries we have now, that don't have lithium and cobalt in them. The cobalt price has tripled in the past 2 years, and it will only have much more price pressure as we start to make more lithium-ion batteries. We shouldn't be launching cars into space. We should be building them cheaper on Earth. I'm sorry, right? We have to find a way to do this, and that's through technology. And so it's supporting technology in our state that if you see, I'm working as an advisor to the Near Zero organization, which has been interacting with the state in order to help steer the cap and trade program. And one of the things that Mary and Ralph have heard from me before that they'll hear it again is, it would be really, really nice if we all teamed up and found a way to take a few percent of the revenues of R&D, of the revenues under cap and trade that are exchanged, that are in the billions of dollars just in California, and find a way to do what we couldn't do in Prop 87, which is take that and fund these innovators in the small businesses, in the universities, in the national laboratories in our state, to help us deliver the solutions that we need affordably to make those regulations come true for everybody. So that's a tee off to you. Thanks very much for listening.